Good morning or afternoon, APW Scholar. Just a reminder, you should not have pressed play unless you have read the expectations on the first page of your packet for today. If you have read the first page of the expectations, you are ready to proceed to the lesson. Today's lesson is Poetry 6, Literary Terms Part 1, Extension, and this is the step lesson. Let's begin by writing our name, today's date, which is April 23rd, and your period on your paper. You should be in your assigned computer with something to write with and this packet. If you have those two things, you are ready to begin. Let's first start by going over our computer expectations since it has been a while since we've done our video lesson. You must read and review the computer expectations below prior to using the computer in class. If you agree to the terms, sign the contract at the bottom. First, sit at your assigned computer only. Keep your heads in air traffic controller position. That means that you are sitting up looking at your computer screen. Stay at level zero, which is silent 100% of the time. You should not need to whisper to a partner or talk to me without raising your hand. Do not get out of your seat unless you have given permission. Follow all classroom rules and expectations. If you need assistance, raise your help flag using the Velcro on the side of your computer. Complete only the assigned work. Do not go to other websites. If you do go to other websites, you will be immediately removed from your computer and your parents will be called. Do not change any of the settings on the computer. This includes the font size, the sound effects, and the display. Keep your headphones plugged in at all times. If you unplug them, you will mess up the settings on the computer, and I will become quite frustrated. Clean your station and tuck in your chair when you are dismissed. Please also make sure that you hang your headphones on your computer. Now, you're going to write your name on this line. Agree to follow all the computer expectations in this class. If I do not, I understand that I will receive a phone call home and may not be permitted to use the computers again. You're going to sign here and then put today's date, which again is the 23rd of April. Now you're ready to begin today's lesson. Let's go ahead and read our objective. It says, after generating a multi-flow map with tone and central idea, today I am determining the theme of a poem so that I can become a more proficient reader of literature. I will know that I have met the objective when I have used a frame to write a summary of the poem, scoring at least 3 out of 4 on the expository writing rubric. Let's circle our power verb, which today is determining. We are determining the theme of a poem. That's the important thing to remember, is that today our objective, our plan, is to determine the theme of a poem. Go ahead and rate your understanding of this objective. Remember that at any time, if you need to pause to get caught up, you can do so and then resume. If you miss a step, you can rewind the video and go back and get the portion that you need. Now, you're going to complete the Do Now. Pause the video so that you can answer each of the questions on your own before reviewing the answers. Excellent. Now let's review our answers. It says, the new teacher was as sweet as apple pie on the first day of school. The simile, as sweet as apple pie, means what? That the new teacher was big from eating too much pie, that the new teacher was nice, or that the new teacher was mean? You should have selected option B, that the new teacher was nice. Number 2, Harold's dog is as deaf as a poet and will not, as a post, excuse me, and will not come when you call him. The simile deaf as a poet means post means what? That his dog ran into a post, that his dog cannot hear very well, or that his dog ignores him. If you selected answer choice B, you were correct. Now, number 2. Rebecca had never eaten enchiladas before, so she took a small bite and slowly began to chew. 1 minute later, it seemed as though her mouth was on fire. What is the author trying to tell you about the enchilada? That it was tasty, that it needed to cool off, that it was spicy hot, or that it needed a little water? What did you answer? You should have selected C, that it was spicy hot. They're comparing the spiciness to her mouth being on fire. Number three asks you to respond to this prompt using a complete sentence. Do you like eating enchiladas? You should not have responded with the word yes or no. Instead, you would write, I do or do not like eating enchiladas because blank. And you would complete that reason why you do or do not like eating enchiladas. Now we're ready to move on to the next portion of our lesson, which is an anticipatory set. I will be playing you two sections of songs that have a similar theme. You are going to compare and contrast the two different songs in your double bubble map here. First, I will play you song number one. Now, I'll warn you, these are songs that I picked out specifically because I knew that you would not be so familiar with them. You may not like the song, but that is not the point of this lesson. Here is song number one. All right, nice job listening to this first song. Now, let's listen to song number two. Remember, you're thinking about what these songs have in common and what's different about these songs. Here we go.
Raindrops are falling on my head, and just like the guy, his feet are too big for his bed. Nothing seems to fit those. Raindrops are falling on my head and they keep falling. So I just did a piece of talking to the sun. And I said I didn't like the way he got things done. He's sleeping on the job. Those raindrops are falling on my head and they keep falling. But there's one thing I know.
All right, two very different songs that I'm sure were difficult for you to listen to because they're outside of your comfort zone. Let's think about what are some of the similarities and differences that you found between these two songs. Complete your double bubble map, and if you feel like adding to it, you may. Now, some of the similarities, which I'm going to talk about in particular, were that we both heard about rain in both the song number one and song number two. But when I think about the specific lyrics of the songs, song number one was very energetic, whereas song number two was much more peaceful in how they talked about the rain. But when I think about the specific lyrics, I don't think that these poems or these songs are actually about the rain. I think that they're about life. She's talking about, I'm only happy when it rains. I'm only happy when it's complicated. I think that she's talking about that she finds peace or that she is accepting when things are difficult. Similarly, in song number two, raindrops keep falling on my head, but that doesn't mean that I'll be stuck in bed or whatever it is. Even though things are difficult, life is going to be okay. So I'm going to put that their message is pretty similar, right? Things can be hard, but we can get over it. This right here is what we're talking about today, but with regards to poetry. During the past couple weeks, we've been working with elements of poetry, specifically figurative language, central idea, and tone. Today, we're going to transfer these same skills to determining the theme of a poem. Let's take some quick notes. The theme of a poem is the poet's message to the readers. And the way that we find the theme is we take two pieces of information. We take the central idea of the poem, and we take the tone, or the author's attitude of the poem, and with these two pieces of information, we can determine the theme of the poem. And if you recall, there were three specific requirements for determining the theme. A theme must have a message or sound like advice. A theme must be a phrase or sentence. And a theme should be global. That means that it can apply to anyone. Let's go ahead and take a look at some practice of this, starting with the poem that we looked at yesterday. This poem was called John Who Is Poor by Gwendolyn Brooks. Let's reread this poem. It says, O little children, be good to John, who lives so lone and alone, whose mama must hurry to toil all day, whose papa is dead and done. Give him a berry, boys, when you may, and girls some mint when you can, and do not ask when his hunger will end, nor yet when it began. Yesterday we determined the central idea of this poem. We decided that some kids are poor and hungry. Now, we still need to decide the tone of this poem. What is the author's attitude? Is the author angry? Is the author formal? Is he proud? Is he sensitive and gentle? I might say that he's being very gentle, that the author is, that this is a very kind poem. So if the tone of the poem is kind and gentle, and it says some kids are poor and hungry, what could be the theme of this poem? You have two options. Do you think that the option is give food to John because he's poor, or be kind to those less fortunate than you? Select a theme for this poem. Now that you've chosen one of these themes, either A or B, we're going to take that information and transfer it into this paragraph here. It says, what is the theme of John Who Is Poor? Use details from the text to support your answer. It says, the theme of the poem John Who Is Poor is blank. This is where you're going to write the theme from this box. Okay? It says, the poem's central idea is blank. Here on this line is where you're going to write the information from this box. Then it says the author uses a blank and blank tone. Oh, well, I can find this information in this box here. This information tells me that the theme is blank. Again, I can use the theme I decided from this box here. You should not have drawn these stars and arrows on your paper, but instead should spend some time completing this paragraph. Go ahead and complete your paragraph and you're ready to move on. Resume the video. Let's practice with another poem. This poem was Primer by Rita Dove. Let's reread the poem. It says, in the sixth grade, I was chased home by the Gatlin kids, three skinny sisters in rolled down bobby socks, hissing, Brainiac and Mrs. Stringbean. They trod my heel. I knew my body was no big deal, but never thought to retort, who's calling who skinny? Besides, I knew they'd beat me up. I survived their shoves across a schoolyard because my 5'0" mother drove up in her caddy to shake them down to size. Nothing could get me into that car. I took the long way home, swore I'd show them all. I would grow up. Yesterday we determined that the central idea of the poem was that some kids get bullied. Now, let me think of the tone of this poem. Is the tone depressing? Is the tone romantic? Is the tone angry? I feel like the tone is fairly confident. That the author is saying she would show them all. She would grow up. Come up with another example of the tone and underline your evidence in the poem. Now, based on the central idea and the tone, what do you think the theme or message of this poem is? Spend some time deciding what the theme or the message is before continuing on. All right, now, check to make sure that your theme meets all requirements. Is it a sentence or phrase? Is it something that sounds like advice? And is it global? If you can't check all of these boxes, then you need to go back and revise your theme. If you can check all of these boxes, it's time to re-rate ourselves on the objective. Now that we've spent some time practicing, what's your current understanding of the objective? Circle your re-rating here. Let's continue. Now we're going to read one more poem, and this is called Legacies. It is by Nikki Giovanni. It says, her grandmother called her from the playground. Yes, ma'am. I want you to learn how to make rolls, said the old woman proudly. But the little girl didn't want to learn how, because she knew, even if she couldn't say it, that that would mean when the old one died, she would be less dependent on her spirit. So she said, I don't want to know how to make no rolls, with her lips poked out. And the old woman wiped her hands on her apron, saying, Lord, these children. And neither of them ever said what they meant, and I guess nobody ever does. Let's start by finding the central idea or main idea of this poem, which is the who and the what. So I'm going to circle my clues about who this poem is about and underline my clues about what they're doing. First, I see her grandmother called her from the playground. I'm interested that it says the poem is called Legacies because a legacy is something you pass on from one generation to another. So I'm curious if the poem is about her grandmother, her, or legacies. I kind of think it's about legacies because it says, I want you to learn to make rolls, she said proudly. The little girl didn't want to because when the old one died, she would be less dependent on her spirit. She wouldn't need her grandmother anymore. That's interesting to me. She says, I don't want to make no rolls. The old woman said, Lord, these children, and neither of them ever said what they meant, and I guess nobody ever does. So I think that the who in this poem is actually like the legacy someone leaves. And now I want to think about what they're saying. It says like, neither of them ever said what they meant, and I guess nobody ever does. So it's like the legacy someone leaves is important. I also think that this is about the girl and her relationship with her mother, right, or her grandmother, and it's that she's not appreciating the legacy that she leaves. So I think that's going to be my central idea, is that some people don't appreciate the legacy of others. And in this case, the legacy is like the recipes and how the grandma takes care of her. Now I need to decide the tone of this poem. What is the author's attitude? Is it angry? Is it sentimental? Is it reflective? Or is it something else? Choose one of these or write your own tone. Obviously, you should not have written angry. Now, based on the central idea and the tone, what do you think that the message is trying to be? What is the message the author wants you to learn? If your central idea was that some people don't appreciate the legacy of others, what is the message of this poem? What is the author trying to teach us? Make sure that the message is global, a sentence or phrase, and sounds like advice. Now that you've decided on the theme, You're ready to complete your exit slip, and this follows the same format as our practice, where we're going to use details from the text to support our answer. The theme of the poem is blank, the central idea is blank, the author uses a blank and blank tone through the poem, and this tells me that the theme is blank. Go ahead and make sure that you have completed all parts of your exit slip. Then, what do you think? Do you think that you're at an advanced level, at a proficient level, or partially proficient? If you're partially proficient, what do you need to do to get your score to proficient? Read through the rubric and underline evidence of where you're at. If you've finished this lesson before the end of class, take out your homework packet and silently begin your homework for tonight. Thanks for participating in today's video lesson.